Karangamai te whare karakia, karangamai ngata arangatira, karangamai ngā tangata katoa, karangamai ngā taha toi, no reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa.
Unuhie te rito te harakeke. Hei hea koe te kō mako e kō whakatairangitia. Rere ki uta, rere ki tai, ki mai ki ahau, he aha te mea nui, mā kū e ki atu, he tāngata, he tāngata, he tāngata.
If you pluck the heart out of the flax bush, where will the bellbird sing? It will fly aimlessly inland. It will fly seawards. If you ask me what is the most important thing in the world, I will reply, it is the people. The people, the people. Our connection with Te Manu, the bird in Aotearoa New Zealand, has a long and unique visual history, as evidenced in bird rock drawings from tangata whenua settlements in various locations in Canterbury. Interpretation of these first human voices from the past still echo in this exhibition, within the art of stamps. The connection continues through whakatauki, wisdom, and in a diversity of artworks, whilst bird songs in Waiata release the breath of this aesthetic experience, bringing it to life. Through this specialised miniature art print of birds on stamps, and through the lens, skills, art and craft of painters, sculptors, glass artists, photographers, digital artists and printmakers, birds in all their various forms within the landscapes of Aotearoa are a part of consciousness of those who dwell in this land. Maybe that's because birds are, significantly, the principal everyday wildlife that we experience. So imagine this exhibition, Waiata Manu, Birdsong, as an artist's chorus. As you hear the birds, see the birds, listen and look, but listen also to the voices of their artistic creators. What are they singing as they invite you to ponder the avian art before you? New Zealand stamp collectors tell the story of the world's very first airmail stamp. It was for an airmail service begun in 1897 between Aotea, Great Barrier Island, and Tamaki Makaurau, Auckland. The Pigeon Post. The only link between Auckland and Great Barrier in the 19th century was by steamer, and this proved to be inadequate for urgent communication. The Pigeon Post airmail service was devised. Pigeons could carry up to 4 messages at a time. The message was written on a lightweight tissue paper called a flimsy, upon which the triangular Pigeon Post stamp was adhered and the message attached to the bird's legs. Instead of the hours via surface mail, it took the birds approximately 55 minutes to complete the journey. There was a variance in postage cost. From Auckland to Great Barrier, it was 1 shilling, whereas in reverse, it was 6 pence, due to the greater effort required to train the birds to fly to Great Barrier than to teach them to fly home to Auckland. Triangular stamps were printed for this local use, but drew disapproval from the National Philatelic Societies, who warned collectors that they were not official stamps. The service lasted over 11 years, and it only ceased after an underwater telegram cable was laid in 1908 to speed up communication. The New Zealand identity with land and landscape has been well established within landscape art. These miniature and specialised art prints form a part of the Waiata Manu chorus because every stamp tells a story, as the philatelists remind us. Within the hundreds of New Zealand stamps with birds, there are many diverse narratives. These smallest of art prints trace a trajectory that starts with a Victorian fervour of empirical and imperial pursuits, where New Zealand's first birds on stamps are engraved and captured within elaborate Victorian framings. They reflect a sense of the exotic acquisition or the taxidermist's specimen. The original brown kiwi made its stamp debut with 3 other species, a pair of huia on the 3p postage stamp, and a pairing of the kaia and kaka on a 1 shilling stamp. These birds were the first official images selected to represent New Zealand along with 3 landscape pictorials. A survey of the numerous birds on New Zealand stamps, land, sea, wetlands and game birds, substantiates the exhibition premise that birds play a role in the portrayal of a New Zealand identity. The image of the kiwi perhaps at the forefront of this identity. In the 21st century, we observe strong conservation objectives, stamps of endangered species, extinct birds, recovering native birds, and hopes for a predator-free future. Bird art, like the nation, has evolved, with bird stamp designers creating from their own milieu. Donald Hall Binney was born in Auckland in 1940 and died in 2012. He's celebrated as New Zealand's most modern and renowned bird artist. Donald Binney opens this section on conservation because, along with his love of birds, he had a heart for conservation. The tomtit happens upon the viewer suddenly, in black, white, shading tinged with ochre against a grey background. The tomtit fills the frame through this shared lens of Binney's bird-watching binoculars, zooming in and capturing stylized features, as he did with his other birds in the 1960s. Binney makes them larger than life, disproportionate to their surrounds, and leaving no doubt that the bird is the focal point. Te ko mero mero, or the tomtit, as seen in Simon Stewart's photograph, were considered sacred by tangata whenua and were believed to be bearers of good news. If one is described with the phrase he konehi ko mero mero, having the eye of a tomtit, it implied a careful observer, for the tomtit indeed observes carefully as it looks for small insects. Painter and ornithologist Donald Binney was a careful observer. He saw features of the land in the bird, and of the bird in the land. In 1983, Binney explained, "I think a characteristic of this and a lot of work from this period is the structural coordination of bird and landform, physical resonance between one shape and the other. Why? Because as an ornithologist, I've always been thoroughly involved in the way in which land, the environment the creature lives in, modifies the creature. The creature also, of course, modifies the land. It's symbiosis, really, isn't it?" This bird and land correlation in his art was to become characteristic of his oeuvre. In later decades, he readjusted the compositional dimensions to include more of the bird's surrounds. Around the 70s, Binney's perspective zooms out, for the viewer to glance more land and sky, whilst retaining the stylized design components of the landscape mirrored in the bird. This work, The Last Flight of the Kōkako, from 1979, also known as The Fall of Icarus, was used to fundraise for conservation protesting efforts in 1980. The protests were against the state's deforestation plans for the West Taupō Forest, deforestation threatening the habitat of the Kōkako. Greeting cards were made to raise funds and their designs taken from this painting. The beak of the Kōkako is echoed in the shape of the mountain peak in the background. The hues of the Kōkako, rather than taking on the colour of the landscape, are contrasted with a warm yellow sky. Perhaps a prophetic warning of global heating with the loss of our forests, the painting also recalls the wings of Icarus melting near the sun. The bird with land symbiosis in perspective is observed again in another painting from the 70s, which was also used for conservation purposes, but this time in Cinderella stamps. The original painting upon which the Cinderellas are based can be found in the Te Papa collection. A bittern flies over a New Zealand landscape. Although large, the bird does not occupy the greater portion of the canvas as with fat bird. In the 1980s, the New Zealand government launched an economic plan under the National Party leadership of Robert Muldoon, dubbed Think Big. One of the many schemes was the proposal for an aluminium smelter to boost the country's revenue, and this was to have been built in Otago's Aramoana. The residents of the township of Aramoana were having none of it, and supported by environmentalists from around the country, they strongly resisted by declaring themselves the independent state of Aramoana. Launching a campaign to demonstrate not only against building a smelter on their turf, but their independence from New Zealand, they issued their own stamps. Ralph Hawtrey and Don Binney hastened to their support with artwork printed on stamps for this newly formed state. Thus it was that Puke Totara, Twice Shy, became a stamp design for the independent state of Aramoana. The bittern, a bird found in wetlands all over New Zealand, is said to be a mysterious, shy species described as cryptic. When threatened, it uses camouflage by adopting an upright, reed-like posture rather than resort to flight. What is Binney's cryptic message in the ambiguity of the landscape identified in these stamps and in an earlier painting called Once Bitten? Birds and environmental concerns are a well-recognised theme within Nigel Brown's works. Once a student of Colin McCann at Elam, he also knew Binney at Elam in Auckland and through various art circles. Although Nigel Brown and Binney were acquainted, according to Brown, they were not bonded. Yet each painter recognised that the landscape is integral to the life of the bird. Brown's concern for the natural world is seen in the strong elements of his compositions. A series of his works with postage stamp-like effect with a distinct double border. Intaglio-like dots portraying the cellular. Earth, grain, seeds, which are important to the bird and important for regeneration, are observed throughout the contained composition. A clear conservation call rings out from this work. Bird and land and people each have a role to play in our part of the globe. In both Kākāpō and Tui for Holders, there is lament and warning over the loss of wildlife and habitat, a kind of writing on the wall. There is much happening in these words and works. In each painting, Brown's environmentalist is dressed in a black singlet, looking solemnly upon the bird with apparent concern, endearing us to this Kiwi bloke, who, with great sensitivity, allows the bird to rest on his person. He in turn is supported by his mate. Combined with the words framing the pictures, these paintings are poignant signposts to caring for the land. The interdependency between birds and nature, and people and nature, even while they explore themes of New Zealand male identity. Juxtaposing Brown's works with Binney, a discerning viewer to the Waiata Manu chorus may observe a discord between the Fred Dagg fashion of the black singlet in Brown's works and Binney's direct repudiation of being perceived as a black singlet conservationist. Yet, notwithstanding this difference of character, there is ultimately harmony in the acknowledgement of the unity of the environment, wildlife, and humanity. In the artist's chorus, listen out for a contemporary counterpoint to Pākehā artists. This counterpoint includes the voice of Tangata Whenua, including the works of artist Amber Smiths in her prints, Tūmanako and Karakia, and in Sophia Minson's The Heart of the Kaka and Ruru. They draw from Māori wisdom proverbs and prayer that blend seamlessly and beautifully with the art. Amber is a ceramic artist and printmaker based in Whakatū, Nelson. She draws inspiration from Te Ao Māori and nature. Her aim is to spread messages of love, hope and self-worth through her ceramics and prints. She uses this graffito print method for her prints. In her print, Tu Manako, three tui flit about a stylized landscape within Aotearoa that encapsulates elements recited in the Pepeha, the Māori introduction of oneself that finds identity in the landscape, Te Maunga, the mountain, Te Awa, the body of water, along with Whakapapa. Amber's words on the print read, Kore hi ake nā manu, ta kiri mei te ata, ka oa, ka oa, ka awa tea, tihei mauri ora. The birds call, the day begins, and I am alive. In combining whakatauki and waiata, proverbs and songs, both in te reo and English, she hopes to educate and connect. Her words of wisdom are intended to uplift, in her words, lending a beautiful feeling to the art. Contemporary artist Sophia Minson was born 1984 in Auckland. She takes inspiration from landscape, the stories of Aotearoa, and her mixed races, Ngāti Porou, Swedish, English, and Irish heritages. She celebrates the storytelling and wisdom of culturally diverse ancestors in a modern world. In her 2018 painting, The Heart of Kaka, she combines a digitally created Victorian wallpaper as a backdrop to an earlier work, combining the past and the present, while the spiral motifs on the kaka add another layer of interpretation. Tai Muli has been a sculptor for 25 years and has an affinity with stone. He employs traditional carving reflecting unity, kotahitanga, in this contemporary version of a waka huia. Tangata whenua recall the role of manu huia as the bird anointed to inform Tane that he was to receive the three baskets of knowledge from the highest of 12 heavens, each of which is remembered in the 12 white-tipped feathers of manu huia's tail. These feathers brought mana to those who wore them. They were so highly valued they were traded across the islands and kept in special carved wooden waka huia. The now extinct huia was last sighted in 1907. Much has been said and written about this species of bird, sacred to Māori, who highly prized those white-tipped feathers. There is a story that when the Duke of York, heir to the British throne, visited New Zealand in 1901, he was presented with a huia feather that was placed in his hatband. The huia feathers then became a very much sought-after fashion commodity in Europe. Conservation concerns expressed by both Māori and Pākehā and efforts to try to preserve the species were unsuccessful. Introduced predators, deforestation and private agendas for commerce or science resulted in their extinction. Tai Muli's waka huia pays tribute to the huia. Bill Devoy's female huia, carved in black tākaka stone, gives a sense of permanence to the huia. Curled into her tail feathers in a posture of sleep, she watches. Minray Yang's exhibit, The Lover's Eye, 2021, of mixed media, is mesmerising. The painted eye of the huia looks out from an exquisitely decorated brooch and is thematically linked to the huia lament. The brooch borrows from the popular 17th century Georgian art trope of the lover's eye, where the painted or sketched eye of a loved one, framed within an item of jewellery such as a brooch, communicated intimacy and endearment. Eyes have long been considered windows to the soul, and her miniature gem offers an introspective searching. But when Yang transfers the lover's eye to a painting of a bird's eye with all its connotations of peripheral vision, the eye of the huia, a symbol of kaitiaki, it becomes visionary and watchful. Devoy's second sculpture was especially created for this exhibition. The tui, a much-loved songbird, is renowned for its double voice box, unique to this species. Sculptured from raglan basalt, the tui, drawn to the white marble Corphi blooms, perches upside down on the trunk of a tree made of alpine stone. The bird is a wonder of craftsmanship, but is more than this. For centuries, sculptors have spoken of releasing the art or being within the stone. Devoy brings forth the bird from the rock, freeing its spirit that it might take flight. Birds, after all, should be free. This work, then, is a metaphor for the song of the soul set free. Luke Jacobs' glass manu are of different species in various modes of flight. They tweet joyful, bright, colourful and optimistic notes. Tui, fantail, waxeye, tomtits, swallows are among this delightful array. Carsten moulds using wax. The glass birds have a translucent glow of light and colour, bringing them alive with character. Jacobs' birds have winged their way to the US and Europe and can be found in private and institutional collections. Jacobs himself has travelled to glass studios and kilns in the USA, Europe and China for work and to explore glass art practice. That some things ought not to be, so in my best, my very best, I'll set you free. Janet Marshall was born in 1947. In her work, she paints in the tradition of the artist-observer painting from nature. However, a visit to her website will reveal that she is a prolific bird artist who is comfortable in a range of styles. A renowned stamp bird artist with 14 bird stamps to her credit, her illustrative renderings are informed by extensive study of birds and her everyday proximity to bird wildlife in her studio in Nelson. She is the consummate bird artist, with her birds appearing in a list of bird specialist guides, children's books, greeting cards, and New Zealand currency. Along with her stamps, Marshall has two paintings in this exhibition: fantails with coprosma and acrylic on mounted canvas, and stitch birds, also in acrylic on mounted canvas. In these works, Marshall's rendering of a soft, diffused light in the foreground of fantails with coprosma might be contrasted with the layers of light in the bush backdrop of stitch birds. When viewed together, they combine into a unified depiction of an atmospheric stillness in an isolated New Zealand bushscape. Judy Lapsley Miller volunteers in wildlife conservation projects, including at Zealandia Eco Sanctuary in Wellington. Photography is just the first step in Judy's creative process. She digitally blends and masks layers of photographs, graphics, scanned ephemera and textures, lighting and colour adjustments and digital brushstrokes to form an image that is more painting than photograph. The digital image is then realised in physical form as a jiggly print on archival fine art paper. In this exhibition, she's donating a percentage of any sale proceeds to supporting Zealandia Eco Sanctuary. Regarding her work, a real Kiwi joker, Kiwi Puku Puku, she writes, "We go for an evening stroll with one of our most precious manu. Kiwi rely more on their sense of smell than sight, so they snuffle and snort as they forage, as if sharing the funniest joke. This is the sort of Kiwi joker I want to spend time with. They're fascinating birds with the most haunting call and silvery feathers that shimmer in the moonlight. Male Kiwi Puku Puku pull their weight on the home front too. They are the primary caregivers for their chicks." In Alexander Okoplov's digital print, Unbroken Song, There is a sense of foreboding in the darkened sky as a group of whiteheads face an impending storm. How do birds, with their delicate feathers and features, when caught in a tempest, ever survive? The reality is that sometimes they don't, or they may end up far from home. For Alexander, the answer is suggested in the title, Unbroken Song. This painting, a metaphor of weathering the storm, also acts as a reminder of disturbing cyclonic weather patterns and natural disasters on account of global warming. Alexander's whiteheads are rendered after the style of the 17th century European old master, looking to realistically replicate the subject in the fine detail of the birds. Like an old master, his impressive chiaroscuro creates mood. Unlike an old master, no pigments were mixed on a palette. Digital technology is manipulated to paint the composition, create depth through light and dark shading, and all without a single brush stroke. In the most abstract work of the exhibition, Sean Hill's preparatory design uses digital painting to emphasise the interconnected elements of the natural environment, the homes for our birds, earth, sea, sky. This work, Tui, designed on his laptop, will be finally rendered in acrylics onto a polished palette. Bird photography is a hobby that has turned into a way of life for Martin. It has seen him venturing into all sorts of precarious situations, always listening, always watchful, always chasing the birds and chasing the shot, for the sheer love of it. Lauder uses a quality Sony point-and-shoot with a 600mm zoom, rather than an SLR camera, as it gives him flexibility to take the camera along in other activities and seize the opportunities as they arise. Such is his passion for this hobby that over the years he has accumulated a catalogue of over 70 local bird species. His wife has apparently observed that their walks are now taking much longer. The photograph I spy is of a dotterel, Tuturi Fatu, captured at Martin's Bay an hour north of Auckland. The viewer is invited to wonder, what does the bird spy? In Lauder's second exhibit in this exhibition, Heading Home, he has captured the gannet in flight, with wings outstretched and almost camouflaged against the swirling and breaking white water below. Above the surf, he is homeward bound. Simon Stewart is an observer of New Zealand wildlife, and birds are a recent addition to his photographic repertoire. Concentrating on birds in 2020, he has now photographed numerous species. Of Stewart's range of bird pictures, the images of his male tomtit perched on a branch and that of fledgling swallows find a welcomed place in Waiata Manu. Currently, neither of these species is considered threatened, but they capture, as only photography can, a realism of the natural world. There are many stories that come with Stewart's bird images. Often, they serve as wildlife commentary. For example, in his photograph of fledging swallows, Stewart captures an endearing moment of the parent feeding the young. He found the swallow chicks habitually perched for food at the back of one of the Western Springs ponds. Whenever the parents approached with food, both chicks would clamour to be fed. Although the chicks are perched, the parents never land while feeding them. But equally, they do want a good, positive transfer of the food to the chick to prevent wastage. There is a season for every purpose under heaven. Responding to the call to bird conservation, the art team decided to use the Art Week Waiata Manu platform to raise awareness about endangered birds, and especially the fairy tern, of which 40 to 45 birds only remain. The Fairy Tern Trust is a private conservation group working alongside the Department of Conservation for the Eradication of Predators and working to raise community awareness about the plight of the fairy tern. A Somerville artist collaboration, keen to raise funds for the survival of the endangered fairy tern, have created 40 flax and papier-mâché birds for the exhibition. These are of the genus Imaginatio, or of the imagination, with their species named by the artist. These birds are for sale, and proceeds will go towards the Fairy Tern Trust. Kindergarten Kiwi. This collaborative artwork, along with the tile bird mosaics and clay manu, were made especially for the exhibition by Upland's kindergarten teachers and children. In early childhood learning, there is an emphasis on the value of the process rather than the result. The Upland's teachers also appreciate the absolute value to korero during the process, that is, to engage a child in conversation. The results are birds that might grace any home. Created under the loving guidance of the teachers, Upland birds underscore a big hope that new generations will respect and revere the importance of manu and whenua, bird and land. Somervell and the art team hope that you do find within the Waiata Manu chorus a fresh appreciation of the natural birds, along with the metaphors and interpretations often associated with birds. There is joy and delight, mixed at times with elements of lament for our lost species, lost forests, and lost possibility. But still there is hope. There is always hope. Somervell Presbyterian Church is most appreciative for the support and work of all those who have made this exhibition possible. To the painters, sculptors, glass artists, photographers, digital artists, printmakers and community collaborations, we say thank you.
Thank you.